welcome to today's Strategic Farming Let's Talk Crops program. We are happy that you've joined us for today's session. As today, we have Jochum Wiersma here today with us to talk about small grains and expanding your rotations. As always, these sessions are brought to you by the University of Minnesota Extension with generous support from the Minnesota Soybean Research and Promotion Council, as well as the Minnesota Corn Research and Promotion Council. With that, I'll turn it over to Jochum. Jochum?
Okay, well, good morning. I see 66 people in attendance right now, 73. By the time we reach 100, I suppose I owe somebody a drink. I kind of look at these sessions always kind of like stump to chump, because it really should be interactive. I like to hear your questions in the chat, and I'll try to keep up with that, or in the Q&A box. There's no open questions yet, but I have a whole bunch of PowerPoints, and I'm not sure which one to start with. So given that I have a bunch of them, I'd like to hear from you right now. Do we want to talk just spring wheat varieties? Do we want to talk a little bit of cover crops and how they mesh with in a corn soybean, and if how they mesh with small grains in the rotation? Because there is a couple of issues there. We can talk winter rye. Let me know. In the meantime, I'll start with one of the questions that was submitted online. How do I control water hemp in small grains? Now, on the front side, if we do a normal weed control pass, water hemp, like there's plenty of options to get the small water hemp out of your small grains. Bromoxynil plus MCPA works most cases as long as that water hemp is small. But I think the question is more about as the small grain starts to dry down, water hemp has this bad habit of basically continuing to emerge. That's when the things start to green up and you have problems with weed control. Or basically you can't use glyphosate for pre-harvest Roundup. And so then you're going like, I don't want to SWAT. What other options do I have? So both Valor and Spark, I think it's Valor and I got to make sure that I not become a liar because I don't know them all by heart. Valor and Sharpen, not Spartan. Both have labels for as a pre-harvest aid. Now, when that water hemp is tall enough, all you're going to do is basically annoy him, but they're going to dry down a little bit on these larger water hemp, but they will help make life a little bit easier. So the two options you have for pre-harvest weed control, because we basically can assume that the water hemp is going to be glyphosate resistant, is to use Valor or Sharpen. I hope that answers that question. In the meantime, winter wheat is cover crop, cover crops and rye. So I am going to start with a talk now that probably will create some discussion called The Law of Unintended Consequences. It's a talk that some of you might have already endured this winter. Just a minute. Now let's see if we can get the technology to work the way it should. Come on. You're always able to prove any of Murphy's laws the moment you try to do this with a live audience. There we go. Everybody see that?
You're good.
Good. So I gave this talk all of last week across the South. So some of you might have seen this. There's a lot of hubbub about soil health. And then the newest word that we hear a lot is regenerative agriculture. Now, if we talk soil health, we have to have some definitions. And it's the continued capacity of soil to function as a vital living ecosystem, that top 12 inches that sustains plants, animals, and humans. Now, the biota that make up that living ecosystem contains all kinds of fun stuff and sometimes not so fun stuff like soybean cyst nematode. But they're all part of this ecosystem that we farm. Now, the next couple of slides are brought to you by a very cynical bastard. I am now far enough in my career that I can actually say this. And so I have a couple of questions for you, and I want you to think about it. You don't have to share your answers, but do you need soil to actually produce plant-based food, fiber, or feed? No, because if you go to Target nowadays, some of the greens that are packaged are from urban farms, basically an old warehouse where they hung a bunch of LED lights in, and then they do everything with hydroponics. Does a healthy soil, by definition, eliminate nitrate leaching or phosphorus leaching? Not necessarily. Does healthy soil eliminate wind and water erosion? Not necessarily. And the question that I hear a lot, or a lot of talk in, when we talk about soil health, is this resiliency and having these soil communities. There's a lot of attention even in, you know, some of the biologicals making the soil happier. Okay. Any of you ever seen fallow syndrome in corn in the spring? Well, that's because the previous year, the mycorrhiza population in that soil, because nothing was grown there, that hence the term fallow syndrome, happened because that population crashed because nothing was grown the previous year. Now, within a month after that corn seed is planted, that mycorrhiza community is kicking into gear again. Now, does that corn always catch up and not see a yield difference at the end of the year? No, some years you're going to carry it all the way through harvest. Some years the corn actually grows out of it because that soil community rebounds that quickly. There's some really cool work that was done by a grad student about 6 years ago in Wisconsin that looked at how resilient these different soil communities are. And it's amazing, you know, with quantitative PCR technologies, we can track how these communities bounce back as a function of rotation. And it's amazing. Now, so why is all this hubbub about soil health and regenerative agriculture? One of the questions we should really ask ourselves is are our systems crashing? Are we losing productivity? Now, when you run across a field with a 12,000 bushel grain cart, when it's wet, you're doing a whole bunch of structural damage. You're creating compaction and everything else. I don't think that really should be in the same definition as soil health. That's just destroying the structure of the soil and has not that much to do with soil health, in my definition. Now, is it just the issue du jour? Is it fashionable to talk about it, much like bell bottoms or laser shoots? Or is it really a proxy for a larger issue? Now, a definition that I do like is ecosystem services, because it recognizes that what we're doing across the landscape that we transformed from a prairie to a what we could ecologists would call a disturbed ecosystem, aka farmland, is that we try to get benefits from for us humans. And in that functioning, there is clean air, there is extreme weather mitigation, but there's also, and this gets a lot of attention these days, especially in legislature and in the popular press, this human mental and physical well-being. you know, in the UK, in the Netherlands, those two aspects are much more important in the political discourse than, say, even the extreme weather mitigation or the function or the production of food and fiber. And so restrictions are placed on that disturbed ecosystem that we call farmland. Now, with that come two questions. If we have indeed ecosystem services across this landscape that we call farmland, then right away, you have to answer two questions. And those are the two in the bottom here. I'm not going to read them to you, but I'd like you to think about them. So the 12 inches of magic that we farm, what does it all do? It does do nutrient cycling. It does do carbon sequestration. All that biota that's there does take care of a bunch of pest problems through predation. It does do waste decomposition. The bacteria communities in there are absolutely phenomenal in decomposing all kinds of things that we throw across that landscape. It does provide water purification and air purification. And if we adhere to the principles of crop rotation, it does provide pest and disease control and flood protection. So I have a standing rule in my project. I do a fair number of trials with herbicides and insecticides and fungicides. Nothing that I am going to apply in a trial is going to come back to the lab. So we measure out our product of choice for a particular trial. We mix it up in a 1 liter bottle, not a quart bottle. After all, we work at the University of Minnesota, so we have to adhere to this, you know, the metric system. And then we spray the plots. And invariably, I'm going to have a little bit left in the bottom of that liter bottle. I spray that out. I don't dump it. I spray it out in the alleyways. I spray it out in the grass borders because I'm relying on the soil to basically do the waste decomposition and detoxification. I do that because I don't want to bring it back to the lab because then it's industrial waste and it creates a whole bunch of paperwork. So I use the services provided by the Petosphere every single year. Now, in that, to me, this whole thing is risk mitigation. It's risk management, risk mitigation, which to me is a different word than, and probably closer to the truth than, resiliency. Now, in Minnesota, there's a fair hubbub about winter rye being able to reduce nitrate leaching in the Minnesota River Valley. This is some work, 2006 work that was done in Lamberton, where we started to talk about fall seeded rye as a way to reduce nitrate losses through drainage. So you see four curved lines here, and those are the four planting dates. Well, you have to start pretty early, September 15th, to see any reduction in nitrate losses in the tile in the fall months. It just doesn't grow enough after October 1st to really make a difference. It's a couple of percentages. Okay, but what is more important is that you have to really, you're not going to see major reductions until, well, any reductions really, unless it's the earliest seeded, until you get to April the next year. Yeah, by the end of April, that earliest seeded rye has enough biomass that it can reduce the amount of runoff through the tile by about 30%. It really starts making a difference, and this is where most of the leaching actually curves, is between May 30th and June, when the corn is just not tall enough yet to really start taking up nitrates. Likewise, soybean isn't that much different. So if you look at this graph, you can draw a couple of conclusions. The fall veg, and it wouldn't be any different for winter wheat, by the way. The vegetative growth after soybeans on corn especially if it's not established early enough, just isn't, there's not enough fall vegetative growth to really make a difference. Now, we tend to terminate our cover crops way too early because we don't want the competition. You know, in the case of corn, if you have competition when that is a young corn seedling, you're going to see it at the end of the road in your yields. And this is one of the problems that I had always knew in the back of my mind. I just didn't articulate it very well because to me, the cover crop industry was really in a corn soybean country and in the I states. That's where the attention was. I didn't think much of it for our area. But rye and winter wheat are alternative hosts for a number of diseases and insect pests like hessian fly, like armyworm, BWIDV, et cetera, that if we plant too early, and this is really what NRCS wants you to do, and there's a lot of push to start early, and I'll get into what early means, but as you want, you know, they want, they're advocating as much biomass in the fall, and the only way you're going to get that is to plant prior to October 1st, and as go as early as maybe August or interseed 1st of September. That really closes what we call the green bridge. And if there is in your on your operation, if you have small grains in the operation, you're eventually going to shoot yourself in the foot. So all that together to me says that winter annuals in Minnesota, winter wheat or winter rye, are really a, almost like a Band-Aid on an arterial bleed. If we're looking at nitrate leaching. Now, can you reduce wind erosion? Yeah. Do you need winter rye or winter wheat for that? Probably not. You can probably do it with just oats. It's going to winter kill, so we don't close the loop on some of these things. And so that might be, if that's your goals, be a good alternative to winter annuals. Now, what really brought it home and why I'm talking about it this winter is hessian fly. So hessian fly is one of the earliest invasive species in North America. Interestingly enough, the rumor had it that it was the German mercenaries that came over during the Revolutionary War that brought it with them. That probably isn't true. Nevertheless, the name hessian fly stuck. There's two generations per year, one of which overwinters in winter cereals, winter wheat, winter rye. And it survives as a piperia, which looks like a flax seed or a little bit less flattering term, a little rat turd. The only way we can manage it is hessian fly resistant varieties. That's how it's managed in soft-bred winter wheat. Soft-bred winter wheat breeders always have to select for hessian fly resistance. They're single gene resistance genes, and there's complex interactions, but it's done. In our area, we've never selected for hessian fly resistance. The second thing is, in combination with resistance, is you do not seed your winter cereals before the fly-free date. Remember, there's two generations. If you plant, and the adults only really live about 3 days to lay their eggs, and then disappear off the landscape. If you plant after the adults were on the scene, you basically break the disease cycle or the insect cycle. The hessian fly free date for Minnesota is not as well described as it is for any of the I states. If you type in fly free date Iowa, you get a beautiful map with cutoff dates. Basically maturity, almost like the maturity zones in soybeans, bunch of lines across Iowa from east to west. In Minnesota, south of I-90, it is probably September 30th. Highway 12 is probably September 25th. The line, Alex, Glenwood, Morris is, so high, that would be 14. No, that's not 14. Is probably September 20th. And so you don't plant before those, your cover crop before those dates, or you're going to close the loop on Hessian fly. All the way north, Canadian border, you're still probably looking at September 7th to the 10th. Having said that, that means that that is in diabolical opposition to what the NRCS and some others want you to do with winter cereal as cover crops. So most of the time, Hessian fly in my career has been a biological curiosity in spring wheat production. And then I found it in 2020, or I didn't find it, growers found it to the point where they started calling me, where it was high enough numbers that in a triangle between Twin Valley, Crooks, and Halstead, that people noticed it during harvest. Because if the Hessian fly is able to, if the larvae leave the plant and start molting, they will fall over those stems because they leave a night exit wound, exit hole, and then the stem just falls over. So you see lodging. So there's two hypotheses that might explain 2020 in that triangle. And one of them is has to do with we've had two very dry falls, less tillage, where we would control volunteer. And so we closed the loop with the volunteer spring wheat. Because a lot of our spring wheats actually have some winter hardiness in them. And I won't bore you with the genetic details of why that is, but we see it year in, year out with certain varieties. The second hypothesis is indeed that we are seeing rye as a cover crop in the northwest Minnesota as well. And we closed the loop that way. If hypothesis is true, and we go back to the biology of this pest, when it was the work was done in the 50s, cover crop species like winter rye and winter wheat should that can serve as a host for Hessian fly should not ever be seeded prior to the fly free date to not close that loop, and especially if you have spring cereals on spring wheat in your rotation. Now, on top of that, and this is not really a green bridge or closing the loop scenario, but we are seeing more and more true armyworm flights showing up earlier. And armyworms are kind of funny. They get carried out up from the south with wetter fronts, and they're in this midstream long distance dispersal, mid latitudes, I should say. And when they see the right color green, they'll land. They'll nosedive and they'll start feeding. Now, the right color green is anything that's solid green early in the spring that's a grass. And rye is a perfect example of something that greens up early, closes the rows because it tilled already in the fall if you planted it at, you know, ideal and we had a little bit warmer fall. And they'll be there. Now, if you terminate that rye, those second or first or third instars are going to look around and go, well, I can't eat the rye anymore. Guess I'll start on the corn. And they'll take out soybean stands as well. They don't like soybeans, but hungry makes raw beans sweet. So they'll munch on the beans as well. There were several cases this year where corn had to be replanted several times when it was seeded and standing rye cover crop. So this was really a long sales pitch to start thinking about not as winter wheat and winter rye as a cover crop and an expense, but rather as an actual crop. Because then we already know that crop rotations work. And especially soybeans need a two-year break to really continue to flourish. As weed control gets more expensive, you know, this opportunity cost idea is going to play into it more and more that widening a rotation might make sense. So One more time, blatant sales pitch. With that, questions?
All right, Jochum, you have got quite a few questions here that we've got logged in or coming in here. First one here, actually, do you think that warming temperatures have shifted the traditional Hessian fly-free dates?
That's a very good question. And I do not know the answer. I posed the question to Ian McCrae and to Janet Nodal. The original work was done in the 50s, and we're no longer the 50s, which if everything's indeed shifts further north as far as fall temperatures, that probably would imply that those, you know, those cutoff dates have moved as well. Further or later in the season, we should do the work to validate that, because we honestly don't know. They suspect so, but we don't have the data.
Okay. Next question here, and I believe this is about actually utilizing flax as a cover crop. Do you think flax would be an alternative to small grains in your cover cropping systems?
Oh, good question. Possibly. The problem with flax is it's very fine seed, and so very shallow seeded, which means that in the fall, establishing it in the fall is probably harder than any other crop to get good growth in the fall. The reason rye is such the darling of the cover crop industry is because it's pretty much bulletproof to establish. You know, it's one plum away from being a weed. You go to the Southern Plain winter wheat region and you talk, they'll talk to you about feral rye. Well, that's just basically rye. It's just that rye has some high temperature dormancy. And if it's dry enough, it will get basically become feral, because you're going to see some shattering. It's going to stay around, and then it's very difficult to control in your winter wheat stands. And so there is areas where feral rye is a major problem.
Okay, that kind of brings us back to the top of this. Why not winter wheat for cover crops in southern Minnesota? Is there an issue there?
No, it's the same issue as winter rye. And it's an alternative. I don't think there's a difference between the two. The dilemmas, the challenges are the same. It's about as equally difficult or equally easy to establish. Rye is a little bit more drought tolerant to get established. And you can use it. But if you truly are worried about green bridges, I think oats, especially if you have a livestock operation where you can ensile that oats late in the fall, is a very good alternative, because that oats doesn't need a vernalization. And in other words, it will, even if you seed it, say, after your sweet peas or your sweet corn harvest, even later, it will keep growing in the fall. And it will actually go to stem elongation because it's temperature driven and it doesn't need a vernalization requirement. So you get biomass. And if you leave it then after you chop it or mow it or whatever you do, that stubble is enough to prevent wind and water erosion, one of the ecosystem services that we look for with winter annuals. Does it help with the nitrate leaching? No. But it helps just as much as really late planted rye that gets terminated too early, because you did take up some nitrates out of the soil profile that you harvested and hauled off that field.
Okay. Can you talk a little bit about adding cereal rye into your rotation and how that might help with things like weed control?
Oh, well, you got all kinds of, you know, there's two challenges there. Because we're no longer live in a Roundup ready world, and Jeff Gonzalez and and Deblin have talked to you enough about layering your herbicide approaches and using, you know, soil residual active ingredients. There is a couple, it gets a little bit more complicated. You can see some carryover in dry falls, even if the replant restrictions, you're outside the replant restrictions for the rye or the winter wheat. Temperature has something to do with that. Drier falls, lighter soils, some of those active ingredients will carry over a little bit too long. And so you get some ugliness now and then, and we're learning here too. But let's say we were in a good situation where we're not worrying about the herbicides used in the previous crop. Rye is extremely competitive. Winter wheat is extremely competitive. So as long as you control your winter annuals prior to seeding, you then have a lot of options in the case of winter wheat to really reduce the seed bank in the next spring. The rye is so competitive that if you controlled your winter annuals, there is probably no weeds that are going to emerge during the season because it greens up even earlier than the winter wheat. And you can probably get away with very little, if any, weed control during the rye. But then afterwards, especially if you establish cover crops, some of your later emerging weeds, you have an option to control either through mowing or with herbicides. So there is, it creates a lot of flexibility to start depleting some of your seed bank for weeds that are tough to control in the corn soybean system.
All right, we're going to shift gears here to a little bit more production questions. So here's a one: can we double crop winter wheat and soybeans successfully in southeastern Minnesota?
Not yet.
You say not yet.
Not yet. It ever so often, there's one of my cooperators in the center will try it sometimes if the winter wheat or the winter rye comes off really early. And a little bit earlier, so beginning of June, he'll try to get a triple zero bean in. And he's been lucky enough that some years he actually harvests 15, 20 bushel beans in that double crop scenario. He's also had them completely freeze out. So you have to have a plan B if you do that, meaning you got to be able to chop them and feed them something to something if they don't make it and they freeze too early.
How about if you push it further to the southeast? So looking Rochester, Lambert area, is it still waiting at that point?
It's still, I think it's still probably a 50-50 proposition. We're not southern Iowa, southern Illinois, southern Indiana, or Missouri just yet.
Okay. All right. Looking at this last season, will rye seeded in October that didn't germinate before winter because dry soils still fertilize in the spring if the desire is to keep it for seed?
I see Greg has two questions, and I'll answer that other question above it from Greg as well. So this is, there's a lot of rye that got seeded in very dry ground, and the intent is to keep it for seed. So now we have to go a little bit into physiology. If the rye seed indeed germinated, and the way you can check that is if the radicle, which is the first root, and the coleoptile, the shoot, have come out, but haven't necessarily reached the soil surface yet, that rye is actually already started to fertilize in the fall. If it truly stayed in dry, as dry seed and came through the winter, you likely will not get enough vernalization units, which is temperatures basically between 32 and 50 degrees soil air temperatures, basically. So nice late fall days. It probably won't accumulate enough of those cold units in the spring, because spring around here lasts 2 weeks. We go from frozen solid to 90 degrees some days within, 2 weeks. And once those soil temperatures get above 50, you no longer are accumulating cold units. So the way to check this is indeed the moment you have a chance not to get stuck this spring is to see indeed if the radicle and the shoot came out. If they did, they'll likely make it this spring. You will see reduced yields because that crop won't tiller as much. Because rye is very daylight sensitive and it will very quickly transition. Now, if we have a beautiful March, I looked outside, no, not yet, and April, then it has non-vegetative growth and it will have enough tillers. If we have a very late spring, we won't see very good tillering and you'll see you won't see enough tillers and you'll get reduced yields. Now, is that grower willing to farm without a safety net of crop insurance? Ha! In the case of hybrid rye, RMA is going to insure hybrid rye separately from rye, which changes the actuary tables completely and makes it basically makes the crop insurance program for rye viable, for hybrid rye viable. For winter wheat, right now RMA still considers winter wheat basically insurable as spring wheat in the spring, so that one is covered. If we're talking oats for small grains production, for grain production, the oat contracts, you can now buy crop revenue coverage for oats because RMA in just Minnesota, Wisconsin, and Iowa, they're doing a pilot where the futures market of oats no longer sets the price, but the futures market for soft red winter wheat actually sets the price with a certain formula for oats. I'm part to blame for that. So if this pilot goes south, they can say RMA, well, Jochum said. So there are better options coming out there for crop insurance, which is really critical. I agree with you, Greg. And De Anonymous, I'm not buying the Hessian fly argument. I'm reading this quick. I call it lucky. Indeed, if you're indeed consistently prior to the fly-free date. So the question really is, I haven't seen the problem for 15 years and I routinely plant earlier than what we think is the fly-free cutoff date. Like I said, we don't have completely solid handle on what the fly-free date is. And you just have mite locked out. If I go back to what happens in the South and what would transpose that to here, eventually it will catch up to us.
Something based off of that there, Jochum, and I'm just kind of curious from a forage aspect. You mentioned that plants are falling over. Is this something that we're worried about if we're going to be using this as a cover crop, as a forage in this case, with the potential for that plant to fall over prior to flag leaf or even anthesis, depending on when we're cutting that?
Okay, so generally you get really good growth of oats if you get it in the ground by August 15th. The one thing that is a little bit, if you're really intending it for forage, you want to start looking for crown rust actually at the 4-5 leaf stage and control the crown rust. So you actually have additional expenses in that, but we can do that for less than $2 an acre with a fungicide to maintain forage quality. Can it lodge? Yeah. Does that really affect total biomass production and palatability? Not necessarily, because like any other small grains, it is three strikes and you're out. The crop will have a chance to resurrect itself one time for sure, second time for sure, the third time generally it's game over. And so I've never seen fields, late seeded fields, to really go flat the way spring seeded oats does. How late can you plant? I think August 15th would be kind of a nice starting point. So it really fits if you are indeed working with peas, sweet corn, stuff like that, to generate a lot of biomass.
Greg has a follow-up here to the safety net. Is in reference to your question on grower responsibility to farm for soil health at their cost?
I wanted to leave this. It's too early to have a philosophical debate with a six-pack on the back of the pickup to discuss these things. But there's some of these questions that relate to that. And I leave it to each their own opinion on that. I just posed the question. Greg, since you're close enough to me, we should have that six-pack on the back of the pickup this summer sometime.
I feel like someone should drag a camera out there. Make sure we get this on, get this recorded. All right. Just got a question myself here as well. We're looking at this drought situation in some of those small grains areas in southern Minnesota. And I know like Stearns County area as well got kind of hit with that. What are some of the big challenges you think are going to come up, especially in terms of disease pressures? What should we be looking to monitor heading into this spring?
So, because there's a fair amount of concern about drought, the first thing we want to know is how deep can we go with seeding. Right now, I'm actually running a bunch of trials. It's not really trials. It's basically what I'm determining is the length of the coleoptile. And for each of the species, for each of the varieties, that's a little bit different. Roughly, you can say oats can be seeded deeper than spring wheat. Spring wheat can be seeded deeper than barley, and then taller varieties have more tolerance to deep seeding than shorter varieties. Now, within that, there's small differences, and so I'm actually determining the coleoptile length on a whole bunch of oat, wheat, and barley varieties. Don't be afraid to seed oats 3 inches if you have to. Wheat, probably 2.5 inches if you have to. Barley is the trickiest one because we want to have that crop up as early and as uniform as possible. So we have to those two things. Then as far as diseases, difficult to say. Because I've learned a long time ago that wait 5 minutes and the weather is going to change. A lot of it is in season weather. For oats, crown rust really is in season. There is no doubt in my mind that if we look at the buckthorn this spring, you will find the aciate that are basically the sexual cycle of crown rust. That's what's going to give us the inoculum that's going to go to the crown, to the oats and infect that disease. If the conditions are favorable, then all bets are off. On the residue-borne diseases, tan spot septoria, and even fusarium head blight, last year was relatively dry. The risk is less probably this coming season. But if you are in a rotation, which we all like you to be, it's still a field by field, case by case decision. Overall, I think the risk is a little bit less. If we start looking rusts on wheat, spring wheat and winter wheat, those have to come in from Nebraska in Kansas. Right now they're in a drought, which means that probably is less development, but that can change in a hurry, and that's an in-season decision as well. So insect-wise, I don't know. Grasshoppers were fierce last spring here. We had a dry fall again, which probably means that overposition was very successful. So we might be in for another grasshopper outbreak, early outbreak in Northwest Minnesota. So I'm going to have to answer anonymous here. This is not a tailgate party. This is a very deep philosophical debate.
All right, there's another question up there. Is your recommendation to delay seeding small grains until after the fly-free date?
Ideally, yes. Now, if you don't on your farm have small grains for grain production in your system, on your farm, in your rotation, then I'm a little bit less concerned. If your neighbors are close, because Hessian fly is actually a very weak flyer. It is not going to have long distance dispersal. And so that makes it a little bit easier. Rapeseed overwintering in Minnesota. I don't know. So there is winter rapeseed, and I know the University of Minnesota and Cropland Genetics worked on winter rapeseed. And what I recall is that winter survival was marginal at best, but I'm not 100% sure.
Okay. All right. So I've got another question here. When adding small grains and interseeding clover, which herbicides could be used the prior year that won't carry over to the clover?
Nathan, you want to take this one?
I can sort of take this, especially addressing soybeans in this in particular instance. You know, we've got a lot of research out there from the different university systems across the board, Mizzou, Wisconsin, Iowa State, even Minnesota here. We've got some research on looking at herbicide treatments in the different systems and the carryover effects on cover crops. You know, the biggest thing here always is you got to figure out first what you're going to do with it. If you're taking your interseeded cover crop as a forage, then you have to follow those plant back restrictions. You have to follow those grazing and foraging restrictions and things like that. So then that becomes a clear cut label decision that you have to go and keep track of all of that information. If you're just doing it solely for cover crop purposes, when you're looking at your soybean herbicides coming into your clovers, if you look through that, there's a lot of potential options. I mean, it's really, you know, we could sit here and I could spend the next 10 minutes trying to list them all off. But in this particular instance, most of our options are available if you're using something like crimson clover. When you start dealing with some of your peas and things like that, you start running into some issues with your PPO inhibitors. But the usual rule of thumb is understand herbicide breakdown in your soil. It's going to be influenced by your soil type, your microbiology, temperature, rainfall, and those sorts of things. So you have to deal with it from that perspective. And then the other part of that too is when you're putting down herbicides with residuals, understand what they're geared to control and what they might control on the backside. And so if I'm trying to control something like a small seeded broadleaf or small seeded or like a grass, you know, of some kind, then planting a grass following a residual grass herbicide, if that residual is long lasting, might not be such a great option, especially when you're looking at interseeding. So there's a lot of those things that need to be answered first before you can really try to hone that in. But for the most part, there are tables out there that will have looked through some of that information, looking at the different commonly used products in corn and soybean systems to help us narrow that down.
So Dorian came up with the zinger for today. Assuming that everything is glyphosate resistant, what the heck can I use for pea plant burn down? It's going to be basically everything that Carter had as far as pills and throw it in the tank, because it's not that easy. I'm going to actually have to think about that one, Dorian, for a while. What the most, because it depends a little bit on the weed species, but I assume you're after you're probably after the water hemp because you don't want it to go to seed yet that fall, or are you truly after some of your winter annuals? Because we have a lot less herbicide resistance in our winter annuals than we have with that pesky little thing called water hemp.
Dorian did answer there. Broadleaves mostly is what he's going after.
Yeah, paracot would work. Volunteer rape and soybeans. Yeah. Options are limited. Yeah. See, because your seed production of a water hemp management is different than your winter annuals. I'll have to think about that one a little bit more, Dorian. Grasses are easy in the fall. Volunteer crop is easy. That's just glyphosate. It's with the partner you want to put in that tank for your broadleaves if you're after the water hemp.
All right. Well, unless you have anything else here, Jochum, I don't have any more questions on my end. We are coming up on time pretty quickly here. So again, thank you, Jochum, for being on here today.
And thanks
for everyone for attending this Strategic Farming Let's Talk Crops program here today.